everyone. Welcome to the critical reasoning lecture. The topic that we will be doing today is paradox and cause and effect. Now, although the number of questions of paradox and cause and effect do not come in large numbers in entrance exams, but once in a while they do make appearances in exam, and that's why it's important for us to know at least how to resolve them and to be confident once we see these questions in the exams. Let's go ahead and understand the concepts a bit more in detail. Now, before we move on to understand how to classify causal arguments and assumptions, let's first understand what is the difference. What does this term cause and effect mean? Now, in simple terms, cause is anything that that's an action. That's a stimulus. And anything which is the response to the stimulus is the consequence. Now, consequence is the effect created from the cause. And another point to understand that when we say cause and effect, we are always talking about direct cause and effect. Anything which a cause which leads to an impact directly is direct cause and effect. So that in short means cause and effect. Let's understand few terms. Let's understand what do you mean by causal arguments. Like an argument in which one thing is caused by another thing is the causal argument. Let's look at an example. It says, for instance, an argument might read, the baby started crying loudly 1 minute before his brother woke up. Since the baby and his brother share a room, it is clear that the baby's crying woke his brother. This argument concludes that there is a causal relationship between the two events. So, two things are happening. The baby cries, that leads to the brother waking up. So, we are saying that both these arguments are causal in nature, because why the brother is waking up is because the baby is crying. So these type of arguments where one action leads to the other is called as a causal argument. Similarly, for every causal argument, you will have a causal assumption. When it says, when the argument claims that one thing caused another, the assumption is either that the proposed cause actually caused the effect or that there was no other intervening cause. So basically what we are saying is, if one thing leads to other, we are either assuming that nothing else is leading to the first one, or that the cause is actually leading to the effect, which was the case in the first option. Let's look at an example to understand this slightly better. I'm going to slightly delete this part so that we can focus. Okay, so now the example reads like, in the last 20 years, there has been a significant increase in coffee consumption. During the same time period, there has been an increasing number of public coffee shops in urban areas. Therefore, the increase in the number of public coffee shops must have caused the increase in coffee consumption. Now, what's happening is, two things are happening. Coffee consumption is increasing, and that is being related to the increase in coffee shops. That's what is happening. Therefore, the increase in the number of public coffee shops must have caused the increase in public coffee consumption. So you have assumed that since this have increased, this has led to the increase in coffee consumption. So the assumption that we make is, there is no other cause that is increasing the consumption of the coffee other than the coffee shops. So it is just the coffee shops that is increasing the consumption of the coffee and nothing else. And this type of an assumption where one thing leads to the other is called as a causal assumption. So very, very important for us to understand causal arguments, an argument where one thing leads to the other, and causal assumption where there is no other intervening cause other than the one proposed in the sentence. I hope this point was clear. Let's go to the next one. Now the second category that we'll focus on is the paradox. Now paradox, as you would know, is a seemingly contradictory statement that basically contradicts each other. From a logic perspective, paradox is anything that presents two seemingly contradictory statements and asks you to resolve the apparent discrepancy. What do you mean by discrepancy? Discrepancy means doubt. So any form of doubt that exists in the logic of the sentence, the paradoxical question will ask you to solve the doubt. So after you're presented with the initial piece of information, you will be analyzing. You'll be given a choice of answers. Your job will be to choose the one that best explains the reason for the apparent discrepancy and resolves the paradox. So typically paradox will take 2-3 forms. It will be The question put to you is generally takes two forms. Which of the following, if true, would best explain the discrepancy above? So here also you will have to find and solve the discrepancy. Second one, which of the following, if true, would best resolve the paradox? So here you just have to solve the issue at hand. So let's look at a question of typical paradox. It says the percentage consumption of pizzas in city X has increased by 120% in the year 2017. And in the same year, the consumption of burgers has increased by 20% in city X. So what you have, a city and there are two products, pizza and burger. And for the year 2017, their consumption, the delta, is increasing. For pizza, it is increasing by 120%, and burgers, it is increasing by 20%. Both are increasing. So this also, this also. Now, based on this, the author has concluded that therefore in city X, people prefer more pizzas than burgers. So that's the conclusion which the author has made. Now, if you look at it from the first glance, since pizza is 120 and 120 is bigger than 20, this kind of makes sense. But if you look closely, we are talking about percentage changes and not absolute numbers. And percentage change and absolute number, unless we have an absolute value, the percentage change cannot quantify the absolute increase. Let's take an example to better understand this. Let's say for pizza, the base value is 100. And for burgers, the base value is 1000. When I say base value, let's say the base consumption. So now with the same logic, pizza is increased by 120%. So pizza has gone from 100 to 220. Burgers in the same year, just 20% increase on 1000 has gone to 1200. Now if you see that the base values, the trend is always reversed. So in the base value, once we know the base value, the trend value gets reversed. And therefore, that's the paradox that we will resolve, that the author forgets to mention base value. And that's the error he commits. And therefore, we resolve the paradox by saying that once we have the base values, the percentage increase will make more sense. I hope you understood how to resolve the paradox. Let's go on to the next one. Now, the third type of questions that we will be dealing in this set is called the parallel reasoning. Now, parallel reasoning is nothing but a pattern that you'll have to follow in two separate logical arguments. Any argument that follows a pattern as per the author's logic is a parallel argument. Parallel reasoning questions ask you to look for the answer choice that has the closest logical structure as the argument in the question. Ask yourself which choice best matches the way the author moves from evidence to the conclusion. So basically, let's say for a statement S1, if the logic moves from A to B to C, you will have to apply the same logic to any other statement, and that will be parallel in nature. Let's look at a question. It says, at a certain club, the DJ should play hip-hop music if requested by more than half the crowd. Jay-Z's latest single has been requested by more than half the crowd. Therefore, DJ should play Jay-Z's latest single. So what you're saying is, DJ should play the track if it is requested by more than 50% of the people. So that's the logic. That's the structure of logic that you have identified. Now, let's apply the same logic in the second part. It says Jay-Z's latest single has been requested by more than half. So this part is coming up, which would mean that DJ should play Jay-Z's single, because you're deriving the logic based on the parallel reasoning in the first part. So that's parallel. Parallel argument would mean those who would wish to save in the short term should not invest too much of their money in mutual funds with long-term growth. Marianne does not want to invest too much of money in the mutual funds in long-term growth would mean that she is not willing to save in the short term. So parallel argument is, if X leads to Y and Y happens, it would mean that X happened. So basically, it says those who would wish to save in the short term do not invest in long-term mutual fund. With the same logic, they have given an argument saying Mary Ann does not want to invest too much of money in mutual funds long term, which would mean that she does not want to save in the short term. So typically, how to solve parallel reasoning questions is break down the argument. Now, when you say break down the argument, it basically means figure out elements like premise, conclusion, any supporting evidence that the stress sentence has. So once you've figured out and broken down the argument, you understand the logic. Like how we did in this question, understood the logic of DJ playing the music on request once more than 50% of the people request for it. So once you understand the logic, you try and figure out which options have this logic. And with that, you eliminate the unknowns and you find out the right argument. This way, you process the parallel reasoning arguments. I hope this has given you enough understanding of this. So in this lecture, basically, we did three things. Understood the causal arguments and causal assumptions. Number two, we also understood how to resolve paradoxes. And paradoxes, as you saw, are basically flaws in the author's argument. So once you've identified a flaw, figure out how do you resolve that slightly better. And third is the parallel reasoning argument, where you break down the argument, you understand the logic, and then you figure out which options or of the given options have a logic which is similar to the one given in the question. I hope all this has given good start point to do questions around these three topics. Hope to see you soon in the practice video questions. Thank you so much.